It's week three of Kris and I beating a dead horse. We're going to talk about the 1996-97 crossover between DC and Marvel once again by taking a look at the Marvel Amalgam Comics. The byword starts now. Ladies and gentlemen, nerds, welcome to episode 165 of the Nerd Byword Podcast. I'm Dave. I'm here with my buddy Kris. And this week we are talking about the six issues that Marvel produced under the Amalgam label, where we remix DC and Marvel heroes together to create one universe. But first, as always, it is time for... Kris, what's new?
Dude, I think that Lucasfilm is listening to our podcast. No, I think it might even been our last episode. It was a very recent episode where we talked about how much we are enjoying the Disney Plus Star Wars content, but how it feels like a square peg going in a round hole, making everything a series. And now it's been revealed on a podcast that I love, Pablo Torre Finds Out, a sports adjacent podcast, so it might not be on your radar, Dave, that Stephen Glover, Donald Glover's brother, revealed that the Lando project is now being made into a film. And I just think this is a much better fit based on our previous discussions that we've already had. I'm very looking forward to this. Obviously, everything is hush hush. Everything has a kibosh now with the writers and the SAG-AFTRA strike. Justin Simien, who wrote Haunted Mansion, was initially supposed to write it, but left. And now Donald and Stephen Glover are taking over writing duties. And judged on the reaction to the latest Haunted Mansion, that's probably for the best. But in April, Donald Glover told GQ on this entire project, regardless of if it's a series or if it's a film, what have you, he said, quote, "I'm not interested in doing anything that is going to be a waste of my time or just a paycheck. I would much rather spend time with people I enjoy. It just has to be the right thing," which I think it could be. Lando is definitely somebody I'd like to hang out with. We're talking about it. That's as much as I can say, end quote. And I'm just, again, reiterate something that, an opinion that you and I know we share, is how excited I am for, and I can wait. You know, I'm more than happy to wait. But when this does happen, I'm super excited for it, because I think the world of Donald Glover, he is one of those, like, once in a generation, like, artists, I think. Everything that I've seen of him, whether that's as Donald Glover or Childish Gambino, is just, it's like a modern day, like, Renaissance artist. It's just art in its highest form. I'm a huge, huge fan of his. He's extremely influential on my kids as Childish Gambino. My son, whom you've had in class, he's bound to determine he's going to be the next Childish Gambino. I told him, we had a big talk this week about his future career plans. Just like, pump the brakes, buddy. Like, I appreciate your enthusiasm, but like, so I'm a huge Donald Glover fan. My entire household is, and I'm excited to see this, and glad to see that they're willing to evolve in as needed when it comes to this Disney Plus Star Wars content. Because I'm a fan, but like we said, like, it needs a little bit of tinkering, and I'm glad that they're willing to do that.
Yeah, and I think it's probably at least somewhat a response to the fact that they are looking at probably a real content issue on the big screen if this, you know, strike continues on for, you know, a significant number of months. And so I'm not surprised that they're looking at some projects switching from a series to a potential movie, because otherwise they're not going to have a whole lot here in a couple of years to put on the big screen. But I think it's of great benefit to the project You know, we've talked about this quite a bit, as you've mentioned, but I think that tightening up a lot of this these stories a little bit instead of trying to stretch them out artificially is ultimately going to be a benefit to the storytelling. And I think that, Glover as Lando Calrissian was a real highlight in the Solo movie, which, you know, I think is much maligned for no reason. I like it quite a bit, actually. It's not, you know, it doesn't necessarily stand shoulder to shoulder with something like Empire Strikes Back or even Rogue One, but it is still is very competent Star Wars movie, I thought, and I enjoyed it. And I would still like to see a sequel to that in some capacity, at least. Maybe we can squeeze a Han Solo cameo in there in the Lando movie. But
I'm gonna shoot from the hip here, Dave, in true Han Solo Lando Calrissian fashion. I think we have a revisiting of that movie as an episode coming up very soon.
I think so, and I think it does need some reevaluation. I think Calrissian as a character is really ripe for like a real exploration. As a massive Expanded Universe fan, I can tell you, even in the Expanded Universe, they never did enough with him as a character.
Absolutely.
He very much, even in the Expanded Universe, stayed on the periphery of the story.
Now that I've read at least three of those novels, I have some context. Yeah, I totally agree. He was very much a side character.
Like, and he would pop
his role
up, you know?
His role, you could put anybody in that role. I don't think that was unique enough for me.
He will pop up, and every time he pops up, it is in a very similar capacity to how he was portrayed in the actual movies. That's very much sort of a second tier main player, you know, there and present, but not as important as the core three. And so I think that is a character that is absolutely ripe for deeper exploration. I think is a vast untapped potential. So I'm very, very interested to see what they do with this. I always liked Lando. There's something very cool about this character that is not necessarily morally ambiguous, because he does have a really strong moral core. When you look at all the stuff he does in Empire Strikes Back, he really is doing it to protect the people, you know, that he are under him. But a character who is very good, almost in a Superman-like fashion, of wearing a particular mask, you know, the super suave, manipulative guy, and underneath is this really strong moral core. I think there's a really interesting character to play around with, and I'm hoping that they do him justice.
And I can't think of a better, like, recasting, if you want to say, because I think the world of Billy Dee Williams, like, charisma for days, and like it can be daunting to recast, obviously, as we found out in Star Wars, but I mean, like, they kind of nailed it when it comes to Donald Glover. But you'll have to forgive me, because I've got Starfield on the brain. I was late to recording because I just can't peel myself away from it. So but we have to mine resources in Starfield. That's one of the biggest features, is like, you build outposts. And I think there is so much with the Lando character that is so much untapped potential storytelling. There's so much to mine from that character and from the actors both that have portrayed him. The sequel trilogy, that was one of the highlights for me of a deeply regrettable film. In most cases, in The Rise of Skywalker, I was here for Lando, and there's not near enough. And I want to see where that story continues to go. Now, Billy Dee Williams is getting up there in age, as is Harrison Ford. But like, I'm fascinated by where that story could go. I don't think we'll ever get to see that with his now daughter, perhaps. Was that confirmed? I don't even remember.
I think it was not confirmed on screen, but it was like in one of the visual guidebooks or something that they put out. It's sort of officially confirmed, but was not confirmed on screen.
Yeah. And then I'm just a huge fan of this character, and no shade to Han Solo, but he gets all the love as like the space cowboy, and Lando kind of gets second billing for whatever reason. Especially with those capes, the cape game is strong. I love playing, you know, EA gets a lot of crap for like their Battlefront games, and rightfully so, but like, being able to play as Lando and having that cape flowing in the background, there's just something perfect for me.
Yeah, absolutely, man. You know, Star Wars is definitely the place where the cape game is very strong, period. Vader's cape is a lot of fun, too. Somehow they just knew how to use capes. A little bit of superhero in them, maybe.
All right, Dave, we got some drama going on in your news story.
Yeah, things are about to get weird, and I'm deeply, deeply conflicted about this whole situation in a number of ways. Apparently, there has been behind the scenes some conflict brewing between Bill Willingham and DC Comics. Now, Willingham, of course, is probably most famous for his Vertigo series, Fable. Fables came back, actually, recently, both with a crossover between Batman and Bigby Wolf, one of the characters from Fables, called A Wolf in Gotham. And then an actual, 12-issue continuation series for the long-running Fables book, obviously no longer under the Vertigo imprint since Vertigo is defunct. Fables ran from 2002 to 2015 and has been collected in 22 best-selling collections, has won 14 Eisner Awards, and is probably one of the biggest success stories to come out of the Vertigo imprint, which is, let's be honest, probably as far as like creativity at the big two, probably the best imprint that ever existed. Like Vertigo is just something deeply special to this day. So Fables is a big deal. And so it coming back was a big deal. Conflict has been brewing behind the scenes. And now Willingham has actually come out and made a statement online that due to conflict with DC Comics, he is putting Fables into the public domain. Now, a lot of stuff that came out through Vertigo ran under a contract that is not sort of a freelance hire contract, but more of a creator-owned contract, although these contracts are deeply complex and it is not exactly clear if Willingham truly has the right to do this. DC Comics has come out since with an official statement. Corporate statements from DC Comics like this are extremely rare. And the statement reads, and I quote here, "The Fables comic books and graphic novels published by DC and the storylines, characters, and elements therein are owned by DC and protected under the copyright laws of the United States and throughout the world in accordance with applicable law, and are not in the public domain. DC reserves all rights and will take such action as DC deems necessary or appropriate to protect its intellectual property rights." Now, it's not surprising that they would do this, make a statement like this, because part of copyright protection is that you actually defend your copyright, right? So if there are challenges, you have to take action. Otherwise, you are legally speaking, so kind of like abandoning the copyright, so to speak, because you're not actively defending it. So that's not a surprising action. Willingham has since posted in response on Twitter, or X, or whatever you want to call it this week.
Twix.
Let's call it Twix. Twix. Okay, so he posted on Twix. "Several questions have poured in over Fables rights. No, this does not include the rights to reprint previously published Fables books and stories. And if you come out with your own Fables books, others couldn't decide to reprint them. Create your own is the new order of things. No, I'm not in any way soured on Fables, and I'll happily still sign Fables books and talk Fables at cons. I'm just soured on a certain publisher that joined the dark side." The comic book industry has, professionals have had interesting reactions to this, with many jumping onto the, you know, you go guy sort of approach, because, you know, we're talking still about corporate comics here, and it is definitely, popular to take a dump on those. And especially since so few creators retain rights or get proper payments for anything that they produce, even if it is actually used, even on like big screen projects, you know, the original creators really don't see anything from that. So Willingham taking one of the biggest things that DC Comics has probably produced in the last few decades and dumping that into the public domain as a way of getting back at them feels, from that perspective, really nice. However, there is another side to this, and that is that Willingham is an incredibly political individual, arguably rabidly right-wing in his approach to politics, and oftentimes has started, you know, increasingly, you know, running that through a lot of his works. You know, almost, I'm not one of those people that says I can't get along with, you know, people who have a different persuasion of me politically. However, his particular brand of politics is very, let's say, abrasive, derogatory, attack-based. He makes a lot of derogatory comments towards, you know, liberal politics in particular. I recall a post online that he made comparing wearing white masks due to COVID-19, making the comparison to wearing, you know, Ku Klux Klan hoods, basically. So there is definitely a sort of abrasive political undercurrent running through a lot of what Willingham does in recent years. And it is potentially possible that within that is actually part of one of the reasons that he is doing this, because DC Comics has in its publishing line probably a more liberal slant to a lot of the things that they have been doing. And so there is speculation that at least part of the reason he's doing this is not about standing up so much for creators' rights, but making some kind of grand political statement. And from that perspective, the whole thing feels just a notch ickier. And I will freely admit, as an individual who has, you know, all of the Fables collections on my shelf, the book is very, very good and deserves the accolades that it's gotten. The writing is strong, the storytelling is interesting. And even though, you know, characters will say things that Bill Willingham is very much putting into their mouth to make a political statement, those things are at least consistent with the characters in whose mouths he's putting it. That there is also the additional wrinkle to all of this, that Fables is based on fairy tale characters that are essentially from, you know, from Grimm's fairy tales and are already in the public domain, right?
Right.
So there is that additional wrinkle there. He's already created a work here that is based on public domain characters. So this is probably cruising towards an extremely complex legal battle that is getting ready to start between DC Comics and Bill Willingham. And although you want to stand up as saying yay for creators' rights, there are certainly other things at play here that make it much more difficult to cheer for one party or the other. So one way or another, this is a very interesting news story, very, very complex one that we'll definitely have to keep an eye on. It's very difficult to decide where, you know, standing up for creators' rights, you know, ends and politics begins in this particular situation. One way or another, there is definitely something brewing here that could have implications for comic books and the industry moving forward if this actually goes all the way into the court system, Kris.
And this came on my radar because I follow someone that you and I are both a big fan of, Jamal Igel. And so I saw this on his social media feed, and he posted the original the Bill Willingham Substack and said, oh well. And then in follow-up posts he said, quote, "The amount of ignorance a lot of creatives are showing about what's permissible by copyright and trademark is stunning." And then a follow-up post a couple hours later said, "Oops, I guess he forgot that he only has half the rights to the copyright." So there's so much to unpack here, because, you know, as he states, you know, like, when it comes to the publishers, you have the artists that are involved, and it's funny because there are so many conservatives that want to talk about virtue signaling in comics and in popular media, but then they turn around and do the exact same thing that they accuse others of doing. This is also an episode, Dave, where we're getting ready to talk about your boy Chuck Dixon. And I say that in jest, your boy. I do not ascribe him to you. And it's really fascinating to see predominantly white, male, straight, conservative creators aging over the past 10 to 15 years. And there's a political science, you know, thing that's bandied about a lot with the great replacement theory of how straight white males fear of being replaced by women, by minorities. And so as a reaction to that, they become sensitive and abrasive and attack based. And so, you know, for so many reasons in the past 5 or 6 years, politics has become even more catastrophic and chaotic than it was even before that. Political discourse is dead on arrival in most cases. And it's unfortunate to see so many creators that we grew up with falling victim to this. And so this is going to be a fascinating thing to develop for a multitude of reasons.
And look, there are definitely a couple more wrinkles that I want to add to this very quickly. First, Stuart Moore was an editor at Vertigo, and he actually put a statement on Facebook. And he said, initially, his first post was, "Why is everyone dumping on Bill Willingham? He's publicizing a dispute with a big corporation. I helped review those Vertigo contracts in the early 90s, and I can tell you they're complicated," and complicated all caps. But then later came back and said, edited to add, "I'm reliably informed there's another whole side to the story that isn't currently being commented on." So A, the contractual situation here is definitely complex, and B, there is probably another shoe that's going to drop at some point. And I think the other thing just to mention here is that, you know, I think you're exactly nailing, you're hitting the nail on the head when you say that political discourse is dead on arrival these days. I can tell you that when Fable was actively running in the early 2000s, and you know everybody was talking about it, Willingham was Willingham, right? I mean, he put in a whole thing in Fable about, you know, basically a pro-Israel message in there, and people took note of that, and they were like, well, okay, that's just, you know, Willingham putting his thoughts in there, and then, you know, people moved on and kept following the story. There is definitely a sense that what worked even 20 years ago is not really something that people gravitate
towards anymore. People aren't as willing, and this is one thing that I absolutely credit Gen Z, if you want to attribute it to them. They're not willing to put up with stuff that people just put up with 20 years ago.
You know, that's absolutely accurate. And I think in some corners there has definitely been a reassessment of Fables in that light, very much to akin to what happened with something like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, you know, where people have taken taken a much closer look at the person behind the scenes making this thing, and then kind of reassessing the actual product a little bit. And that is a very, very complex situation. And we've talked before about
something we've done. We did an entire episode on it. And yes, the end result is we didn't get very far, unfortunately, because it's difficult. It's a sticky situation.
To separate the art from the artist. And is that something you can do? And I think there's a case-by-case basis situation there. And it's going to vary from person to person. So this is just a very complex situation, top to bottom.
Yeah, absolutely. And something that's going to be fascinating to see what develops as a result of it, nonetheless.
Yeah, definitely something to keep an eye on. Alrighty, folks, there you have it. That was a lot of nerd news. Let's go ahead and take a quick break. When we come back, we are going to dive into the Amalgam books that Marvel produced as part of the DC versus Marvel crossover in 1996. So stick around. Ladies and gentlemen, nerds, we're back, and this week we got a seriously big... Big Talk! Yeah, we are back with our third week of DC versus Marvel, where we celebrate and revisit the 1996-1997 crossover between DC and Marvel. We have, in episode 163, already reviewed the miniseries DC versus Marvel, pitting heroes against each other. And in episode 164, just last week, we took a look at the first batch of Amalgam Comics produced at DC Comics, six issues of mixed and remixed heroes from both publishers into a cohesive universe. This week, we are turning our attention to the Marvel side of things. Marvel produced also six comics, and they are Bruce Wayne, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., Bullets and Bracelets, Magneto and the Magnetic Men, Speed Demon, Spider-Boy, and X-Patrol. And I am going to, for each of these books, provide a brief introduction, and then I'm going to throw it to Kris as our Marvel expert for his reactions, and we'll kind of bandy back and forth and talk about our reaction to some of these books. We're going to go ahead and start out with Bruce Wayne, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. number 1, written by Chuck Dixon with art by Kerry Nord. Here's the official synopsis from 1996 from Marvel Comics. Driven by the murder of his parents, a grim multi-billionaire focuses his rage by forging Amalgam's premier espionage strike force. Now Wayne and his agents have to save the East Coast from the depredations of the Green Skull. Kris, let's go ahead and dive into Bruce Wayne, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
I just spit laughed all over my MacBook.
That's gross.
Yeah. Dude. Yeah. You know, it's funny because I think this is my first Chuck Dixon book. And so it's interesting in hindsight to see, have everything that we just talked about in our news segment. And I can see the telltale signs of the journey Chuck Dixon would take over the next few decades, and to why he's a problematic individual now, and to why that he has aligned himself with Comicsgate. There's one particular scene where there is some definitely unfortunate language geared towards people with handicaps, with physical handicaps. It was a really tough read. Aside from that, this reads as, I think I texted you, this is almost entirely the plot for Arnold Schwarzenegger's True Lies with Jamie Lee Curtis. Like, this feels like one of those Schwarzenegger vehicles from the 90s, those action flicks, maybe a Steven Seagal film. Like, there's some espionage into it, and we just throw a superhero filter through it. There are some interesting elements that are developed here with the amalgamation of characters. We've seen Bruce Wayne's parents die umpteen times, but the fact that he internalizes that and it manifests itself in a different way than just becoming Batman was interesting to see. Seeing Moon Knight or whatever the amalgamation is being featured here, I'm always happy to see Dick Grayson. There's some Jason stuff. A lot of this stuff seems like it was just put into a blender, as is the case with a lot of this amalgam stuff. You have like this Bane character who's like, no, Nuke, who is like an amalgamation of Nuke, the Captain America adjacent character, and Bane. So there's a clear delineation there. You have Dick Grayson being like the Moon Knight type character, which is really cool. A couple of my faves being mixed together is always cool. So there's interesting elements here. Jason Todd is inevitably developed here. The Barbara and Bruce romance is kind of roll your eyes, but yeah, it's very much a product of its time. And it's basically one of those 90s action flicks with the hot girl on the cover. the hot naughty girl that you're not supposed to like, but you like on the cover. Yeah, it's very much a product of its time. There were enjoyable elements to it, but it was certainly something to behold.
Yeah, you know, I thought this was fine for what it was, besides that moment that you've already mentioned, and the always ickiness of, you know, them trying to in any way, shape, or form pair Barbara Gordon, even in amalgamated form with Bruce Wayne. It just feels icky.
It feels hot for teacher. Yeah.
It's icky every time, and I wish people would stop doing that. But other than that, I thought there was, you know, it's kind of like how we talked about Darkclaw as like this really dumb action movie that was a lot of fun. This one was like adjacent to that, not nearly as fun, but
not
still
as fun. Yes.
Yeah, but still in the same vein of that. And I was generally okay with this book as just a great, you know, big strokes. I thought there was a missed opportunity in having like some kind of forbidden love thing going on between the Green Skull's daughter and Bruce Wayne, since, you know, Selina Kyle got amalgamated in there.
I thought
that would have been more interesting in this particular situation than having this Barbara thing going on.
Barbara very much was the same as Carol Danvers in last week's episode. Like, she's just there.
Yes. And, you know, Dick Grayson having been amalgamated with Moon Knight, I thought it was actually really cool. However, he didn't seem to get any of the Moon Knightiness. Like, there was nothing that's like very Moon Knight except for the costume. He still felt very much like Dick Grayson. I also thought it was really interesting, all these hints that they dropped, that there was like a deeper running connection between Bruce Wayne and Darkclaw. Like, they've had like adventures together, you know? Like, there was a mention that, Jason Todd died when the hyena tried to blow up Bruce Wayne and Darkclaw, right? So there's like
some of these untold stories are better than what we actually got.
Yeah. And of course the fact that the Green Skull basically like faked his death, right, is actually, you know, at least one of those things that I like about these Amalgam books, is when they try to make it feel like not only it has a past, but it also has a future, right? We're in the middle of a storyline, it'll somehow continue. And so that definitely was something that they nailed here. I will say this. If this is your introduction to Chuck Dixon's writing during this era, it is not a good introduction. Chuck Dixon during this era was one of the main architects of the Bat books, and wrote just a massive amount of, for example, Birds of Prey. The entire first, you know, major Nightwing run was his. The first Robin solo run featuring Tim Drake was his. He was probably one of the singular most influential individuals on the Bat books for a while. And despite what he may became, it's a difficult era to revisit.
Can you see that though? Can you see what I'm saying by that?
I can see definitely some tendencies in this one. Yeah. But I will say, man, that early Birds of Prey run in particular, you know, and how he writes the female characters in that, you know, there's the occasional misstep, sure, but like even like the slow growing relationship between Barbara Gordon and Dinah Lance, you know, and how they become these really tight friends. It's just almost like a completely different person wrote that stuff, you know? It's hard to connect those two individuals. Somebody who is apparently very pro comic skate right now versus somebody who wrote a female main character book with the kind of respect that he did for a while. You know, again, ignoring that some of that stuff is obviously going to be weird because of the era it was written in, you know, there are some really heartfelt great moments between those two characters as they develop this deep friendship, that, and it's very hard to reconcile that. But as far as Bruce Wayne, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., it's fine. It's not nearly as offensive as something like Assassins from last week. Woo! It's just kind of there, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, and I don't want it to come across like I'm like, hey, this is whatever. Like, this is a character, this is a creator that you're having to deal with. I've had a lot of the same experiences. William Shatner is one of those people that, like, you love his work back in the 60s as being Captain Kirk, but then he says some really dumb stuff. Really, unfortunate stuff. And I'll give you the ultimate trump card for a very terrible pun. I was the biggest Bill Cosby fan in the world. I watched The Cosby Show every single night. I modeled being a father after him. And it doesn't get worse than that. Doesn't get worse than that. And as, you know, as a parent of queer kids as a parent of a transgender child. I used to be a big Dave Chappelle fan. I can't do it anymore. I can't. One of the most talented comedians. I can't do it anymore because my kids deserve better. So it's a real slippery slope, and it's really tough.
On that note, let's go into something that I found to be a really interesting book on a whole different number of layers, and that is Bullets and Bracelets. What a title for a book,
what
right?
A name.
Bullets and Bracelets, which was actually written by John Ostrander, most famous probably for his early Suicide Squad run, and with art by Gary Frank.
That makes so much sense. Yeah,
Gary Gary Frank is been kind of, you know, a real star as far as his art is concerned, especially with some of the stuff he did on Superman a few years ago. So here is the official tagline from 1996. Years ago, an unlikely romantic interlude between Trevor Castle and Diana of Themyscira produced a child. Now this punishing man and wonderful woman must unite once more to save their son from Thanoside. Yeah, this is really something, Kris. Take it away.
It's something. That's for sure. There's so much here where, like, Diana being the flagship female character of DC Comics are like, we don't quite what to do with her, so we're gonna just put her in about everything. Even with the Punisher, Wonder Woman and the Punisher, just say that like slowly and out loud. Yeah, this is one of the most 90s things ever. I can't. It's just so much. The art's really great. Like, really, really great artwork. Diana's just, like, everywhere. Like, she's in all the things. She's involved in all of this lore, all of this amalgamation. And, you know, we have the textbook Punisher origin story. And, you know, end up, they have a kid together that's been taken by Granny Harkness. A great amalgamation.
Fantastic amalgamation.
And Agatha Harkness, like, just peak. Just, as many folks would say, it's camp. It's just camp. Granny Harkness is just camp. And then you have this really strange amalgamation of Monarch that is Colonel James Rhodes with, I don't know, that seems like something DC that I'm not familiar with.
There was a character over at DC called Monarch. Yeah. I'm assuming they went straight for that, but
okay. Here's another really, they were just like, we're just gonna go for it. We're just gonna lean into the campiness of it all. Big Titania. yeah, and it's something, man. It's definitely, it's not actively bad, okay, but it is very much in the vein of a Punisher comic. It's just not, Punisher has never been a character that I've vibed with, just personal taste. The character and the insignia has been weaponized by people that are less than desirable individuals. But he's fine there, you know, when I've seen him pop up in other books. It's just not one that I seek out. It's just not my cup of tea, and that's okay. But I enjoyed this one. This was a fun run. Anytime I get to play around with like Greek mythology and stuff like that, it's cool. I'm digging, Thanoside was a little bit lazy, you know, in my opinion. There was a cool kind of twist there at the ending, especially with homie's beret. He wore a golden beret instead of a raspberry one. So he's got some great facial hair game going on, and that beret is doing serious work. But you know, anytime I get new Asgard, I get some mythology fused in there. It's cool. And then you have the inevitable most 90s ending ever.
Yeah, for the most part, I like this one. I think there's a lot of elements here that really were interesting. Although I don't think Byrne over on Amazon got the message that Aurora was Diana's beloved adopted
yes,
sister.
Yes, that was interesting because
yeah,
Byrne was
didn't
like,
get the memo there.
Yeah, that was very much a catfight.
Yeah, somebody did not get the memo there that they were supposed to be getting along. But, you know, just to recap, because I mentioned this last week already, the amalgamations here are weird for a reason, because during this era, DC, for a while, Wonder Woman was not Wonder Woman. Artemis won the right to be Wonder Woman, and Diana was running around in this, like, biker outfit, very much what she's wearing in this, and basically trying to superhero still without the official title of Wonder Woman. And so we got, I think, Artemis really got merged with Storm for the Amazon character. And this Diana just seems to be Diana, to be completely honest with you. I don't even think she's really merged with anybody, at least that I can tell. Very much like Bruce Wayne sort of got plucked out of a dual identity into a solo identity, basically. But I like the kind of setup of like these two people that have nothing in common and this like this weird little relationship that they couldn't make work, and now they're, you know, trying to save their kid. I think that's a really cool setup for a story. That they went with the New God stuff, I thought was interesting.
Extreme co-parenting, if you will.
Yes. I think it would have been more interesting if they would have went a more grounded route with this book, more street level, instead of going right away, you know, we're going to go to Apocalypse and all that. And I found the ending interesting, but a little unsatisfying, because basically they had to accept that their child was raised by a bad guy and is now an adult and is also not coming home with them or anything. They still don't have a relationship with them. And there's no grieving about this lost time or smoochy, relationship. Smoochy and move on, right? So this one didn't feel the way it ended, like it was part of like this ongoing story. It felt very much like a climax or something, right? And then this is the end of the line. So I probably would have not ended it that way. I would have preferred if they, you know, left it a little more ambiguous or something, so it felt like this is part of an ongoing story. But I didn't hate this. It's fine, very much like Bruce Wayne, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. It didn't wow me or anything. And I think this is probably going to be a pattern with a lot of these stories. Most of them are fine. Nothing is quite as atrocious as Assassins, but nothing is good as Super Soldier, for example, or Amazon, right?
Or even JLX. My favorite of all these books, Doctor Strange Fate. I still ride for Doctor Strange Fate. That one's my favorite of the bunch.
Yeah, it seems like this set of books in general is just weaker compared to the first collection.
Just mid at best. And then everything I think was strong and at least fun last week, except for Assassins, is one of the most egregious things that I've ever had to read. And so you have that weighing it down. So maybe it all balances out in the end.
Maybe it does. I don't know. Let's go to our next book, though. This one I, again, liked in concept, actually, although I will say that in execution it's a different story. We have Magneto and the Magnetic Men. This is by Gerard Jones and Jeff Matsuda, with Mark Waid credited for brainstorming assist. Here is the official tagline. Eric Magnus watched in horror as his comrades were slaughtered. Now utilizing the technology that his mutant-hating brother used to create the Sentinels, Magnus constructs 5 robots, each formed from a different metal, to protect his fellow Homo superiors. So, Kris, as a huge X-Men fan, I'm sure that you have opinions here, so let's go.
This one's my greatest frustration, because there's so much here that I love. Of like a storytelling possibility. There's so much potential here. Like, look no further than the Age of Apocalypse. Anytime that you put Magneto as like the protagonist, as the leader of the X-Men, as the quote unquote good guy, I'm in. Magneto is far superior to Xavier as like the leader of whatever group. But the end result is just sentient chemicals. Like, it's just, they took the periodic table and some of the names are okay, but some of them, like, come on, Cobalt, just doesn't click. And then you have these weird like Transformer vibes that are just out of nowhere. But there's so much potential here, because I think we talked about this last week. I was so frustrated because I thought, with his brother, what they established in that previous, I think it's the JLX.
In JLX, yeah.
yeah, was his, I thought that was their Magneto, was his brother, this anti-mutant. And I was so deeply offended, and then found out it was his brother. And I was like, okay, I'm in, like, say no more. You've got me. And so there is like the fascinating element of the sibling rivalry and the sibling jealousy here, but I don't think they capitalize on it the way that they should. I think there's so much untapped potential with that. I mean, he doesn't even feature in this book at all, if memory serves correctly. I read it early this morning, but I don't think his brother's in this one at all. Like, why would he not do that? And then it just, I just became deeply frustrated with this, because I think AI is such an overused thing with so many sci-fi. And if you're going to do it, you gotta mind your P's and your Q's, and you've got to have like the best AI artificial intelligence. Are they sentient? Are they actually quote unquote human? Is when you have these deep philosophical, possibly even theological discussions, like The Measure of a Man, like they did in The Next Generation with Data. Is this now surpassed into sentience? You know, even he starts off as an android, and it's such a half-hearted approach, I think, here. It's just the execution leaves a lot to be desired, and I wanted to love this book simply because Magneto is one of my top five. He's one of my top five comic book characters, one of my top five fictional characters to even transcend comics. And there's so much potential here. And then we've got like Transformers, you know, Mr. Sinister is one of the best villains in comics when done right. But now they just made him a Transformer, and it leaves a lot to be desired.
Totally agreed. I think the name of the game here is absolutely potential. I actually really like the idea of Magneto creating like metal robots to actually assist him. I think that's actually a really cool idea. I can't be too hard on like the fact that these robots all are named after different metals and stuff, because that's straight up just the story of the Metalman. Very much this is DC's Metalman right here.
Which I didn't know was a thing that existed until you just now told me that.
And it's actually they're actually pretty cool characters. They just featured in Mark Waid's World's Finest, in an issue of Mark Waid's World's Finest, and had a very cool little appearance there. If you ever want to check that out, they just did a story about a new form of a Mazo, basically, that would control other artificial intelligence. And they featured in that story, and it was quite good. So they're interesting characters for sure. But I like the idea that they're playing with that Magneto basically controls them like puppets. And through the course of the story, they basically achieve sentience. They can start thinking for themselves, and then they choose to continue fighting with him rather than being controlled by him. I think that's a cool basis for a story. I just don't think that it's as well realized here as it could have been. And I totally agree with you that the fact that Magneto's brother doesn't feature in this story at all is a huge mistake, since I don't recall them meeting in any of these Amalgam books. So you have these two characters that are brothers, but they're like opposite ends of the spectrum, and then they don't ever interact. And that's very strange.
And like I said, some of these untold stories are better than what we are told.
Yeah. Some of this background stuff would be really interesting to check out. So I wholeheartedly agree. I think this is probably a weaker book than Bullets and Bracelets and Bruce Wayne Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., but maybe that it feels like that because there is a lot of unrealized potential in the basic setup for this one. All right, that brings us to one of my favorites of this, even though, again, I think it's conceptually better than in execution.
Yes.
And which is, I think, a running theme for this whole situation right here. And that is Speed Demon number one, written, oh my goodness, there's a lot of people involved in this one. We have Howard Mackey, we have James Felder, we have Salvador LaRocca, and Al Milgram all involved in the creation of this one. The story here is the tagline: Blaze Allen teams up with his nephew Wally in a race against time and hell itself to snatch the soul of the Green Goblin. If they fail, the Night Spectre wins the keys to the Netherrealm. Yeah, so Kris, shoot off at your mouth.
This is my most pleasant surprise of both collections, I think. I went in with zero expectations. I've always enjoyed Ghost Rider stories peripherally. I have made my feelings on all speedsters of all variations quite clear. But I really enjoyed this book. But you absolutely nailed it. Conceptually, it's a fascinating idea. Execution-wise, it leaves a bit to be desired. It's not as egregious, in my opinion, as Magneto and his metal men. His merry metal men.
I like that.
The only thing that is egregious here, in my opinion, is the rhyming. Like, some of this is like real nursery rhyme level stuff. Like,
there's a reason for that, and I can get into that in a moment.
Okay, well, I look forward to your reasoning there. That's the only thing that I'm like, oh god, here we go. But everything else, like, I'm here for. Both Salvador LaRocca. I think Salvador LaRocca, I'm just going to say this, I think Salvador LaRocca is the most underappreciated artist in all of comics. Period.
Oh, for sure.
The most, and it's not close. No one talks about Salvador LaRocca enough. To a comic that you and I will talk about till the cows come home, you know what I'm going to say. That sensational Spider-Man annual coming out of Civil War.
So good.
I get teared up thinking about that comic. One of the best single-issue comics. Period, full stop. Regardless of what was happening at the time, regardless of what was to come on the heels of that, one of the best single-issue comics in comic books, period, full stop, and he's a major reason why.
Absolutely.
Salvador LaRocca. His run on Extreme X-Men with Kris Claremont is top tier, probably the most underrated X-Men book of all time. And then you add Al Milgrom as another person working on art. Come on. Just come on. And like, some of the character designs are goofy in 90s, but whatever. Who gives a crap? Because they're gorgeous. And the fact that we have this amalgamation of what are those little big headed guys, the Green Lantern people? What are they called?
Oh, those are the Guardians of the Universe.
The Guardians, thank you. Guardians of the Universe. You have an amalgamation of the Guardians of the Universe and Uatu the Watcher.
It's a great amalgamation.
First page. As a villain, take my money.
It's great, isn't it?
It's so incredible. And then you have some circus hijinks because, of course. There's some stuff that doesn't quite hit as it should. It misses the target. But this was my favorite read, far and away, of these books. It's just so fun. God help me, I may read some Ghost Rider comic books now, because like, this is so much fun.
Yeah, that is exactly right. I had a lot of fun with this one. And I love the name, even Speed Demon, as an amalgamation of Ghost Rider and Flash.
So smart. So smart.
There is a little bit more on the DC side going on here, though, which is why I think the rhyming is driving you crazy, because it is not just Flash and Ghost Rider.
I don't care that it rhymes. It just seems remedial in the rhymes. When I think of situations like that with incantations, I'm thinking, and the font nails it. The font is like this old Shakespearean level King James type of diction, old English. I just like, we're rhyming things that are very 90s even.
Yeah, so what it is there's a third character in there, and that's Etrigan the Demon, which is a DC Comics character, which actually, in fact, does rhyme constantly. He only speaks in rhyme. And so that's where that's coming from. Even if the rhymes are not up to snuff in this one, that's just how Etrigan talks. Yeah, man, this was just neat. I love the art here. The art was great.
Also, Merlin being involved, and
that's all straight up from the Etrigan side of things.
Green Arrow and Speedy being involved as like adversaries. Fascinating.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
This was just really solid altogether. You know, like, I really liked this one. I almost wish I could get more Speed Demon. I love the design, particularly of the Blaze Allen Speed Demon. I think that is just such a great design. It really works in the context of the story.
Harvey Osborn, come on.
Harvey Osborn as the Green Goblin is fantastic. Yep.
And him not being the direct adversary, but like this person caught in the middle was fascinating.
Yep. And I love how they do the whole Barry Allen, Wally West thing here, basically, where they actually, you know, they end up by the end of the issue being, you know, sort of partners. But then you have this lingering question at the end of if you know, Blaze Allen has been bound to Etrigan the Demon, then who in the world has Wally West been bound to? Like, there's such great intrigue. It's a great cliffhanger. I really like this one, even if I know that some things don't hit as good as they should. There's just something about this book that I just really, really like. The base setup and the way the characters interact. A lot of the amalgamations are really on point here, as you already mentioned. I just really like this one. This is out of this collection, this is one of my two favorites.
Yeah, I hope you're seated, which I think you are since we're recording. This might be the strangest on-ramp to it, but I think I want to read some Flash books now.
I'm going to tell you something too, though. This just reminds me that I have such a good pitch for a Ghost Rider story. I've been sitting on it for years, man. I have such a good Ghost Rider idea. Like, every time that I just even brush against that character, I'm like, I really got something that would be awesome if I ever would get a chance to write for Marvel. Like I got some for Ghost Rider, guys. I really do. It would
and,
be really
and what
something.
And what I enjoy about when I do read Ghost Rider things, it's so much more than the prototypical, like, sometimes you can stereotype Ghost Rider fans as like the same type of Punisher fans, as like this hyper masculine energy of like bro, like metal music. You can explain so much of that away. But what makes Ghost Rider more approachable of a character is the aspect of the occult and spirituality, and the willingness to go there in a comic is much more fascinating to me.
Oh yeah, absolutely. All right, that brings us to our second to last book, Spider-Boy by Carl Kessel and Mike Wingo. Here we go. Official tagline, he's the world-famous web-slinging superstar. He can stick to walls and his crash pad is the Baxter Building. Not bad for a teenage punk. Now two obstacles loom in the path of the amazing Arach Kid, Bizarnage and King Lizard. This is the other one of my two favorite books out of this, but there is a particular reason for it. I'm not sure if this one resonated with you quite as much as it did with me, but I'm very interested to hear your take, man.
This is a good cover band, Dave. That's what this comic book is. This is a good tribute, or a tribute band even, of like the two popular characters. And like, this is like the most clear cut, like, I get from a marketing perspective, two of their most popular young, quote unquote, hip for the time period characters. Of course, they're going to amalgamate them. There was some interesting things that developed here. Thunderbolt Ross being the uncle was definitely a curveball. The fact that they have the Hulk's world kind of mixed in here as well was an element that I was not anticipating. I thought it was just going to be a straight two into one amalgamation, but that was a pleasant surprise. So there was some stuff here that was like playing the hits. And it wasn't quite as meaningful, but like, I overall enjoyed it.
Well, the reason I think it resonated with me so strongly is because a lot of what is going on here in the base setup is less Spider-Man and more Superboy. So I read, you know, the original Carl Kessel run on Superboy after the death of Superman, you know, and the return, and then they launched a Superboy book. And so, you know, a lot of the base setup here feels Superboyish. And I'm kind of admittedly nostalgic for that era in Connor Kent's life. He was just a very different character back then to what he eventually became. Particularly, Geoff Johns did a lot to change him as a character on his Teen Titans run. And this version of Superboy is really near and dear to my heart. Just this punk kid who's trying to become famous, you know, and at the same time is really trying to live up to the S on his chest, you know. Also, I think you kind of missed the real headline here, and that's that they amalgamated the two clones, right?
Yeah.
Superboy and Ben Reilly Spider-Man. But
that logo on his chest is chef's kiss, though.
It really is, right? There's a lot of cool stuff in this book. I think it's almost overstuffed. I mean, we also have an appearance of the Fantastic Challengers of the Unknown, right? The Fantastic Four and the Challengers of the Unknown.
Here's my favorite part. I've injected evil DNA. What is evil DNA?
Still do not know. But again, this is very much the Superboy stuff, right? Because Superboy wrestled a lot with, you know, I'm a clone of Superman and somebody else, and is that other person bad, and what does that make me? And so they had to throw that in there somehow.
Otto Octavius as, like, the lowly assistant. Yeah, as a lowly assistant, like, was a choice. And interesting. Intriguing.
Yeah. I'll give it that. And, you know, here is the real hammer, I think, if you know your Superman lore a little bit. Okay, a lot of it, I will admit. I really love the ending when the Mary Jane character shows
the
up.
The Insect Queen! Yeah, that was great.
And she's been amalgamated. She's been amalgamated with Lana Lang, the other notable redhead, right? Because Lana Lang was, at one point in the comic books, a character called the Insect Queen. So we got Mary Jane and Lana Lang getting amalgamated here. I thought that was such a deep cut, you know, to bring an Insect Queen here. Yeah, I really like this book. I like this book for how it makes me, you know, nostalgic for the old Superboy book. I like the way the Spider-Man elements were sort of integrated. I thought this one was just very high energy fun. And it just reminded me how fun Connor Kent used to be as a character.
I'll probably, if and when I do dive into that, I'll probably have a greater appreciation for this book. But for what it's worth, like, it did remind me of those early Spider-Man comics that, especially like that Lee Romita era, maybe even a little Lee Ditko. Probably a little bit more Lee Ditko. But yeah, it was fun for sure.
All right, this last one that we have is going to be the hardest one for me to really say anything about, even though it also features Carl Kessel in the writing. This one was weird to me,
Kris. And Barbara Kessel as well.
Yeah, I struggled with this one, man. So we have X-Patrol number one by Carl Kessel, Barbara Kessel, Roger Cruz, and Jan Holdridge. Here we have the official tagline. Pharaoh Man, Elastigirl, Dial Husk, Niles Cable, Shatter Starfire, Beastling. Six outsiders unite for the first time to face the dreaded despot known as Dr. Doomsday. Before you say anything, I don't even give a crap. Dr. Doomsday is an amazing amalgamation. Freaking Dr. Doom and Doomsday, because they both share Doom in their name. I'm there for it. I don't care how cheesy that is. Dr. Doomsday was awesome. But other than that, I don't know, man. What do you think, Kris?
You nailed it when in our text thread, it's forgettable. Like it, the only thing that's memorable is Shatterstar Fire is super hot. Like I had a counter of like the butt shots it was pretty egregious. She inexplicably has Shatterstar's like headgear and shoulder pads, but then the rest is just Starfire. This is an amalgamation of all the worst 90s tropes, I think, in comics. It's the Rob Liefeld of amalgamations. This is like just X-Force with a little bit of Teen Titans sprinkled in. You have Beastling, I think was his name, but it's like the amalgamation of Beast Boy and and Beast from X-Men comics. He sexually harasses, Shatter Starfire right off the bat, just like no shame. And then it's so forgettable. Like it's so like 90s. That's the biggest thing I can say about it. Like some of the characters' designs are cool. The Colossus amalgamation character, Pharaoh Man, terrible name. We get it. Fe is the periodic symbol for iron, but Pharaoh Man doesn't do it for me. The design is cool, almost makes him look like a luchador.
yeah, it kind of does.
And then, like, whatever they're doing with Cable, there might be a DC character that I'm not. Cable is the most eye-rolly character in all of comics. If we could jettison him, that'd be cool. I just I don't even know, man. Like, yeah, it's a comic book that happened.
It's a comic book that happened. Thank you, because that is exactly what I was going to say. I did not.
Dr. Doomsday looks cool. Say that.
Dr. Doomsday was the only good thing about this book to me. Like, the rest just is so forgettable. I've already forgotten it. Like, that's the other thing. Like, it's X-Patrol, right? So it's like the Doom Patrol is in there, but for some reason it doesn't have that Doom
Patrol. Oh, I didn't even make that connection. Duh.
You know?
Yeah.
And some of the characters don't really make sense for Doom Patrol. Like, for example, Beast Boy was, a Doom Patrol character for a while, not just a Teen Titans character. He kind of bounced back and forth. But why is Starfire here? Starfire, as far as I know, has never been part of the Doom Patrol. Part of the Doom Patrol always was that these are people that are like real outsiders and messed up and can't really integrate into regular society. And then you got like, the hot princess from Temeria or something on there. It's just like, it makes no sense, right? So that is, it feels a little bit,
yeah.
In that sense, it almost feels a little bit like Assassins did, in that it is
very much
feels so. A lot like the leftovers being amalgamated. Like, here's a bunch of characters we're just going to have to amalgamate because we don't know where else to put them. If that makes sense.
Yeah, just not as egregious. Yeah, there's some generation. Yeah. There's some Generation X and X-Force here. Generation X being Paige Guthrie, Husk, who could just, instead of her innate mutant ability is a little bit gross. She can peel off her skin and like just have whatever type of skin she needs, so she can have adamantium skin. She could peel that off, and if she's in another situation, she can have kryptonite skin if need be, if we're making an amalgamation. But she just like morphs like Mystique level. Like, she doesn't even pull that off. Like, it's such a weird. And then you have like Janet Van Dyne, a Marvel character, being amalgamated with Domino, a Marvel character. It was weird.
Yeah, this one is just deeply forgettable. So if you had to like give a final verdict on these six issues from the Marvel side of things, what are your thoughts here, man?
Of these six right here, give me Speed Demon, man. Give me Speed Demon. Maybe I'm more into the occult than I let on between this and Doctor Strange Fate. But like, that was the most enjoyable far and away. Wasn't even close. There are elements, and maybe if I were to revisit Spider-Boy with more context, I'll appreciate that deeper. Also, we're in 2023, and I've made my feelings clear about the new Spider-Boy. And so maybe that has skewed my opinion as well.
Yeah, when that Spider-Boy book was announced, a whole bunch of older comic fans went on Twitter and were like tweeting at Dan Slott like, there already is a Spider-Boy, dude.
Which I thought was hilarious. He came on and in textbook Dan Slott fashion, I swear, there can't be a more like coin flip of a creator, because some of the stuff I really dig and some of the stuff that he stands up for, I wholeheartedly support him. But then, like, it's Dan Slott at the end of the day.
it's a complicated feelings, yeah.
If Dan Slott wrote for one of these Amalgam comics, then I think it'd be a perfect choice, because I'd feel conflicted about it.
It's funny too, because if you're looking at the second set of issues, the ones that Marvel put out, they're definitely on the weaker side. It feels almost like the DC side of things, they were much higher flying, but then they also had probably the biggest failure out of the bunch. So maybe they were greater risk takers in their approach. And these,
help me out here.
Played it safer. I don't know.
Other than Howard Mackey and Sal LaRocca, none of these jumped out at me as being like Marvel mainstays creator wise.
It's interesting, yeah, because Carl Kessel was writing and Chuck Dixon both were writing extensively for DC. Gerard Jones had been involved in Green Lantern for a little while before Ron Mars took over. Strander is more closely associated with Suicide Squad. So, I don't know what the state of the industry was and if these people were doing more Marvel than DC work at this time. But, like the stuff that I know them from, obviously, because I'm just more of a DC head, are mostly DC things.
And what I do know of them, I know them for DC. Like, even, like, Howard Mackey, I know from Clone Saga. And say what you want about the Clone Saga, I don't think like the actual scripting and writing was the weakness. It was the indecision of going back and forth on who's the clone and what have you. I don't think the writing, the scripting was a problem.
No,
so I Howard Mackey is the only like scribe, at least. I don't want to make it one-sided when it comes to the writing, but like maybe that's why these were underwhelming, is because maybe they didn't have a grasp of the Marvel counterparts of the characters, other than
maybe
because I
superficially
I feel so underwhelmed overall when it, you know, as a Marvel
character. I mean, as a whole, I think if you look at the 12 Amalgam books that they put out as a whole, I think there's a lot of really interesting stuff going on. It just seems that when they collected them, the six that fell on the DC side were maybe five out of the six were really significantly better, I think. I think if you swapped out Spider-Boy for Assassins, the DC side of things, because Spider-Boy feels a lot more DC-ish than Marvel-ish for some reason, I think the DC collection would be like the home run, and the Marvel collection would be sort of the island of misfit toys, with really only Speed Demon, you know, sticking out as a solid effort.
Yeah. Yeah, I wholeheartedly feel that. I think also just gives me, I think this entire experience, man, I said it last week and I'll say it again. Ron Mars and Mark Waid, they know how to cook.
And they do, and they still do.
The ends of the earth.
And they still know how to cook. Let me tell you, some of the recent stuff is still really good too. Alrighty, folks, there you have it. Next week, we are going to revisit the whole amalgam concept one more time as we discuss who we would amalgamate these days if DC and Marvel decided to do this experiment again. I think it's going to be very, very interesting, and I would love to hear your thoughts on that topic. You can find us on social media at Nerd By Word, or individually at That Nerd Dave and at That Nerd Chris. I think next week is going to be a particularly interesting discussion. Before we go, though, we have one more break, and I don't know if you noticed, but the calendar says it's October, which means it's time for Nerd Nightmare to return. Stick around. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. As you know, in the month of October, our nerd commendations take a break as I, Dave, a very long in years fan of the horror genre, decide to introduce Kris, the big chicken, to a whole bunch of scary movies. Yes, it's back. It's time for And this week, Kris is being introduced to a true cult classic, and that is 1981's The Evil Dead, written and directed by Sam Raimi, starring Bruce Campbell as Ash Williams, Ellen Sandweiss as Cheryl Williams, Betsy Baker as Linda, Teresa Tilly as Shelley, and of course, Ted Raimi under a whole bunch of old lady makeup. Here is the tagline of the movie. Ashley, Ash Williams, played by Bruce Campbell, his girlfriend, and three pals hike into the woods to a cabin for a fun night away. There they find an old book, the Necronomicon, whose text reawakens the dead when it's read aloud. The friends inadvertently release a flood of evil and must fight for their lives or become one of the evil dead. Ash watches his friends become possessed and must make a difficult decision before daybreak to save his own life in this, the first of Sam Raimi's trilogy. Also, Sam Raimi's first movie and probably one of the most famous indie horror movies ever made. Kris, was it a little gross for you?
So here's the trade-off. I'm willing to subject myself to this every October. You're going to have to click that pen, because we pride ourselves on our family-friendly rating, and we push that boundary with this episode, with this film.
Okay, here's the pen. Let's do it.
This movie's disgusting. It looks like the inside of a diaper after a stomach bug. That's the greatest takeaway of this. I can definitely see, you know, one of the benefits of being a part of this podcast and kind of picking creators' brains, yourself included, is you kind of see tendencies. I like to think that I'm much more well-informed when it comes to things like this. The Raimi-isms, if you will, even something as recent as Doctor Strange.
Quick cut close-ups.
Yeah, so that was interesting to kind of see, like, the origin of that, if you will, as an ancient history fan. I like the origin, the etymology, the birth of things, and how they were developed. And so that was an interesting aspect to clear. It just left me feeling super gross. I had to shower afterwards because everything was grody and nasty. Cool note, this was filmed about an hour from us, Dave.
Yep.
So that was cool to see.
Because but, if you want to be in a, if you want to be in the scary woods, you obviously want to be where we live.
Yeah, so that, I don't know if that was comforting or not.
I don't know how to feel about this one.
You know, listen, as I said, as a fan of ancient history, getting a nod to ancient Sumeria and the cradle of life, not cradle of life, that's Lara Croft, the Fertile Crescent, excuse me. My brain's fried now, reading crappy comics and watching this late into the wee hours of the night and the morning. I felt like I was Ash Williams in some respects, fighting off Magneto and his metal men and 90s tropes galore, and then following that up with this. Yeah, it was an interesting development. You can definitely see from the onset, and I have the benefit of hindsight that Bruce Campbell and Sam Raimi are kind of tied at the hip, you know, him showing up in Multiverse of Madness, him showing up in the Spider-Man trilogy and cameos and stuff. Also, one of like the connective things, I'm a huge, huge, massive, massive fan of The Impractical Jokers, one of my all-time favorite shows. Just, you want to just sit down and have a good time, have fun. And Brian Quinn, one of the mainstay cast members on that, is a huge Evil Dead fan. And so one of his punishments was to have to go through, like, Bruce Campbell came on to, like, help punish him. And, like, so I saw, like, that. So, like, he made him go through the stunts that Bruce Campbell would have to go through and stuff like that, or the stunt double or what have you. So I had some previous knowledge of this, but yeah, the biggest takeaway is this one's just gross. And I think he gets a chainsaw hand in subsequent films.
In the second one, yes.
Yeah. The other one is, like, it's interesting because is this intended to be a satire?
You know, I'm not sure. It doesn't become really satirical, I think, until the second one. That's when you start getting a little bit of the Sam Raimi humor in there. And then by the third one, Army of Darkness, it's basically the prototype for what would become Hercules, The Legendary Journeys, and Xena Warrior Princess, which are both, you know, Sam Raimi produced series, right? That style of action and that style of humor is basically what you find by Army of Darkness. It becomes less horror the longer you go. Out of the trilogy, I think fans generally agree that the second one is the best because it balances that satire and humor with what they do in the first one, sort of the gross out horror, really, really well. And to me, the second one definitely is the better movie. But it is fair to remember that this was a very, very low budget movie. I think it was made for like $300,000 or something like that. And they did some really cool stuff in this movie with that, at least in my opinion. I really liked like the point of view shots of like the possessing spirits and how they go through the woods and that low drone that it makes. That's a great tension builder. And let's be honest, the scene in the woods with the tree is with the vines is like really, really, really disturbing and tension producing.
Yeah, for sure.
There are things in here besides the gross out that are real great tension builders. And I think
that's a big thing. It was like the almost like the Hitchcockian, if you will, like,
yes,
suspense of like, will they, won't they do this thing? Was fascinating to see. The reason I ask, was it a satire? Because if not, then it might be like, again, we're kind of punting backwards to 1981. This might be like a watershed moment in the development of horror movie tropes And I don't know if that was intentional or not, or like contextually speaking. And I say that to say just this: white people doing dumb stuff in horror movies. Like, get out of there. When you drive across that bridge and you barely make it across, like, at what point do you think that this is a good idea to continue? At what point? Right there, from the onset. None of this is going to end well for you. Okay? Your girl, and your baby sister and your buddy Steve, not happening.
I will say that it would be interesting, perhaps, you know, we're not going to do like an Evil Dead retrospective, but perhaps next year to do part two, because it's really one of my favorite movies I've ever seen. It's just such a great experience to watch that one. But I think this is a much more, Evil Dead 1 is a much more seminal moment as far as horror goes. I mean, if you put yourself in 1981 and you watch something this gross out, you know, on the big screen, that was highly unusual for the time. And it got really strong reviews on the back of how far it was able to push the envelope.
Yeah, I think so. I think just personal taste. I think the gratuitous gore, if you will, is just not my cup of tea.
I think the reason it works for me in this particular movie is because of the practical nature of the effects and that it's makeup and everything. I watched the most recent Evil Dead movie, Evil Dead Rise, and I walked away from it not liking it. And it had nothing to do with the movie makers. It was very well made. It's a very well made scary movie, but it still retains this really over the top grossness. Only now it looks incredibly realistic. And I walked away from it feeling more disturbed than like I got off of a really good, you know, horror roller coaster ride. You know what I mean? Like, for me, a good horror movie puts those thrills on you, and then you walk away at the end and you feel like you've been on a roller coaster. You know, there was that shot of adrenaline and you felt really good about going through the experience. And this time when I walked away from it, I did not feel like I'd been on a really fun roller coaster. I just felt kind of weirded out and grossed out. And I think that maybe is part of the problem for me of more modern horror movies sometimes, is that, you know, because the effects have become so realistic and so convincing that it's not fun anymore to, you know, nudge somebody in the rib and be like, hey, I wonder how they did that. You know, that looks kind of cool. Now it just looks almost too realistic. And so this one doesn't bother me in any way, shape, or form, because I've tried to watch more modern ones and it's become too realistic, I think, for my tastes.
It's also been a full calendar year, so maybe this, I just have to reacclimate myself. I do want one final note. I just want you to pronounce for me the actress that portrayed Cheryl Williams, because it's just going to make me happy.
Oh, I already closed that window on my screen here. If you want me to go ahead and bring up the cast again, I can.
Just
do
because that German accent is going to make me so happy. Last name.
It's Sandweiss.
Yes. Oh, it makes me so happy.
It's basically translated. It means white sand.
Love it. I love it.
Oh. Yeah.
It's makes cool me think name. Of my favorite Sound of Music song, Edelweiss.
Ah, yeah. All right. Well, you survived your first experience, but don't worry. We got four more horror movies coming up this month. So it's going to be quite a
ride. Can't we just talk about how much I love Starfield? We'll just make that the entire month's feature.
We are actually going to revisit Sam Raimi again. One of his later horror movies, when he returns to horror towards the end of the month. And I think that's going to be really interesting. We can kind of see how his tendencies have evolved. All right, folks, there you have it. That's it for another episode of the Nerd Byword podcast. If you like what you just heard, get on your favorite podcasting platform, subscribe, drop us a rating, drop us a review, never miss another episode. We are available wherever podcasts can be found, including our very own spiffy website, nerdbyword.com.
And if you have ideas for further episodes, the algorithms on all social media platforms are skewed because we refuse to pay for it. You could find us, though, at Nerd By Word on all social media platforms, on Twix, Instagram, or whatever things you might be following us on. You can also email us for show ideas, unless you're one of the weirdos that are trying to get us to invest in Bitcoin as our current inbox. Nerdbyword@gmail.com. But as always, stay well and stay nerdy.
The Nerd Byword is written and produced by Kris and Dave, two nerds with a love of all things pop culture. The podcast features music by Al Jimenez, with additional drops composed by Joe Biondi. Our show art is by Ashery Design. Find us at nerdbyword.com and wherever podcasts are available.